Like to open the committee of the whole at what I have 7:05 approximately, and I'd like to call it to order. The first order of business is any disclosure of pecuniary interest and the nature thereof. If you could please declare it. We've not received any written notification, and I see no indication. So thank you very much. We're fortunate today. We have some delegations. Our first delegation, 3.1, is Jennifer Keys, Chair of the Port Hope Public Library Board, regarding annual Port Hope Public Library Report. And Jennifer, I'm going to turn the floor over to you. I appreciate you coming to the Committee of the Whole.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor. I hope everyone can hear me okay.
I can.
And members of council, thank you for this opportunity to talk about life at the Port Hope Public Library over the past year. Let me begin by thanking you for the plaque which was presented to the staff, library staff, in recognition of their continued good service to the public despite the pandemic. The staff are grateful for that acknowledgement of their efforts. They know they're doing a good job, but it's nice always to hear it from someone else. As the performance statistics I provided demonstrate, even though we are operating for fewer hours with limited capacity and only in one location, circulation numbers at the Mary J. Benson branch are up by about 9% over last year. Perhaps people have run out of things to watch on Netflix and have returned to reading, or maybe it's because the library staff have done an excellent job of providing diverse and interesting virtual programming and activities. Since June 2020, the staff have delivered accessible library service at the Mary J. Benson branch, either as takeout or through limited in-person access, while of course keeping visitors and staff safety a top priority. Circulation at the hub, of course, is a different matter. What is interesting to note though, is the increased use of Wi-Fi connection at that location, despite the building being closed. People in the rural community continue to use that location for reliable access to the internet, something which the municipality needs to keep in mind as they plan for the future of that building. We are planning to reopen the hub branch soon once all the appropriate COVID safety measures are in place. Considerable time and effort were spent over the last year in the assessment and selection of an upgraded integrated library system, affectionately called an ILS. The new Circe Dynex Symphony system will enable the staff to serve patrons in improved ways by allowing for a robust online catalog with visual graphics, including colored book jackets, enhanced data content, accessibility features, as well as integration of social media. The launch date for the community is expected early in January 2022. Books, of course, remain the mainstay of the library. The staff have developed some innovative ways of letting the public know about new additions to our collection. The many windows at the Mary J. Benson branch provide space for colored photocopies of the new book jackets. Staff have created unboxing videos to share the delight of opening the boxes of new materials as they come in. These videos were shared on Facebook and TikTok. The staff are continually adjusting the collection to meet the needs of the community. And as a consequence, this year has seen the addition of a significant number of titles dealing with mental health, depression and anxiety, as well as reference books on the nature of viruses, pandemics, and the transmission of disease. No surprise there. Our monthly What's On newsletter is not just in print, but also on Facebook, our webpage, and promoted through Snapped, Kojiko, and the local community radio station. And while in-person programming is still not possible, the staff have devised many virtual ways to continue to connect. The Youth Advisory Group provides an opportunity to local high school students to earn some of their volunteer hours by doing video book reports, which are shared with others once a month via Zoom. In January, 15 students registered for that particular program. Their videos were posted on Facebook, TikTok, and Instagram. This summer, staff ran the TD Summer Reading Club with 42 participants who took out close to 600 items over the course of July and August. New Peeps, a group for those new to Port Hope, and Unfinished Business, a stitchery group, are examples of the virtual outdoor programs available through the library that continued to provide ways to connect with our neighbors even during the pandemic. Of course, some former initiatives are still proving to be popular. Throwback Thursday, these are posts which highlight items from our local history database. The Caterpillar Watch, which provides a fascinating look at our ever-evolving natural world. And Where is Yannick? The mysterious appearance of the Yannick Brisson cutout in various places around town encourages us to get out and explore. For those who aren't familiar, Yannick Brisson is Murdoch from Murdoch Mysteries. And while in-house crafts are not possible yet, a grab a craft is. Each month, a different free craft in a bag, ready to put up, pick up, and do at home. These are things we've done before, but which are backed by popular demand. In an effort to connect with all age groups within the community, partnerships with Early On, a preschool group, and Empire Crossing Retirement Community have been formed. This summer, Story Hour took place in Memorial Park with 28 participants, and 11 residents of Empire Crossing listened in on a presentation about the history of nursery rhymes. These were in-person presentations made following all the appropriate COVID protocol. Some new initiatives include the book walk, which are enlarged pages of a storybook posted along a path in a public place so families can enjoy a story as they walk and play. And the mini art gallery, somewhat like the mini libraries, but for artwork. And speaking of mini libraries, there are now three more located at the Town Park Rec Center, Big Wood Park, and the Alex Carruthers Memorial Park in Garden Hill. These were installed with the assistance of the Rotary Club of Northumberland, Sunrise. Coming soon to the hub will be the Gadget Library, kitchen gadgets for loan, just like books. The efforts of our friends of the library group have been hampered by the constraints of COVID, but they have been a tremendous help to the library by providing greeters who help ensure that COVID protocols are in place. As well as this past month, they held a fundraiser, highlighting two local gardens and providing some gardening tips to help participants prepare their gardens for winter. Their members also help with our huge used book sale held up at the Hub, an event made more successful through their participation and the participation of the Bewdley Lions Club and their wonderful food truck. No cake this year, but good food nonetheless. And of course, there is more, but even this short list gives us an understanding of how busy and active a place the library is. On a more mundane level, the library board and the CEO have been working on both a comprehensive IT plan and a more detailed financial plan, both of which clearly demonstrate the need for increased, sustained financial support if the library is to maintain and improve the services it currently provides to the community. In August, we ran a community survey, and the responses to that will help guide our service moving forward. All in all, despite COVID, it has been a good and productive year at the library, and I would happily answer questions if you have any.
Thank you, Jennifer. That's a great presentation, and I think a lot of the successes, as we said, to the staff and yourself. I'm going to open it up to questions or comments. I think Councillor Carr would like to say something.
Yes, I'd just like to thank Jennifer for all her efforts as chair of the library board, and CEO Margaret Scott for everything that they've done to try to keep all these diverse options available to the community during COVID. So thank you, ladies, for all your work, and thank you to the staff.
Yep. Thank you.
Deputy Mayor.
Jennifer and Margaret, you run a very non-traditional library. In the days I remember going to the library, it was quite different in terms of attitude and presentation. And I think it's just wonderful that you're doing all this. So congratulations to you and your staff.
Thank you.
I think those comments echo all of us. Anybody else would like to make a comment? If not, I would also like to add thanks to Councillor Carr. She keeps us up to date on a regular basis, and I don't think we've ever missed her giving her support of the library. So that is really, I think, important and very helpful to Council and certainly to myself. So thank you, Councillor Carr, as well. And with that, if there's no other questions, I'm going to ask if Council will accept this delegation for information. And could I have a mover, please? Moved by the Deputy Mayor, seconded by Councillor Mink. All those in favor? Thank you. Moving on to our next delegation, I'd like to welcome Bobby Dawson, CEO of United Way Northumberland, regarding United Way Northumberland initiatives. And Bobby, I saw you're online here, so it's now your platform.
Good evening. Thank you, Mayor and Council. I appreciate you having me here tonight. I'm going to attempt to share my screen here so that you can see my presentation. One moment. Can everyone see that okay?
I can.
Okay, great. Thank you. So as you may or may not know, Northumberland United Way has been in Northumberland County for just over 50 years, so I'm going on 52 years now. I'm going to try to control the slideshow here. Whoops. This is our staff team at United Way. We are the largest funder of social service programs outside of government, working closely with all of our community partners, both within the sector and cross-sectorally, to look at some of the issues in the community and how we might best problem solve around those particular social issues. We serve folks from Port Hope all the way to Brighton, up to Trent Hills. So all of Northumberland County, we have services that reach all of those even more rural areas. As you may or may not know, a lot of those services are central to Cobourg and Port Hope, just in terms of location, but we do have outreach services that reach the more rural areas. You may or may not know that 1 in 3 people in Northumberland County access a United Way funded program or service. So when we think about how that impacts their families and then the greater community, that ripple effect is absolutely immeasurable. This is Steve. This picture is representational to protect Steve's identity, but he is a real person. And he's someone in Northumberland County that, as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic, felt as though him and his family had lost almost everything. And as a result of the funding from United Way to some of our community partners, he was able to get the support that he needed. And now he feels as though he's able to slowly put his life back together. This is a common story during the pandemic. So many folks who had not had to previously access supports funded by United Way have had to ask for support around food security, income security, housing security, all of those things. And so really important that our partners are there to support these people like this. Our impact, last year we put $951,801 back into Northumberland County essential programs and services. So that was due to support from local donors, provincial partnerships, as well as federal partnerships through the Emergency Community Support Fund. We also developed the COVID-19 Community Relief Fund in response to local need. And since March of 2020, we've invested over $45,000 in local programs and services. And we are about to invest an additional approximately $40,000 into local programs and services. And this is a fund that's available to any social service program in all of Northumberland. We allowed for this fund to be flexible and responsive to community needs. So unlike some of our other funding, like our annualized funding and grants, this fund has a bit more flexibility so that we're able to respond more quickly to those that need it most. This has allowed us to serve over 30 organizations in Northumberland County. Typically, you might see Northumberland United Way supporting 6 to 8 agencies through annualized funding and maybe a few more through our grants process. But because of these partnerships and because of the flexibility of this fund, we've been able to get even greater outreach through the pandemic and have been able to serve over 30 organizations. We do our work in 3 focus areas. We help kids be all that they can be. We move people from poverty to possibility, and we build strong communities. Under our All That Kids Can Be focus area, 354 families joined the Rebound's Triple P Positive Parenting Program this year. That is such an asset to this community. It looks at a holistic approach to child development and teen development with the understanding that a child exists in a family unit, and to support the family unit is the best way to offer that child a better future. 179 children accessed the Big Brothers Big Sisters mentorship programs that provide guidance, friendship, and positive support for kids. And 92 children participated in online musical training through Sounds in the Next Generation. This is Laura's story, very common. So both her and her fiance were off work for a few months because of COVID. And they had 3 kids that needed to go back to school and they needed supplies. And so through our backpack program, they were able to receive supplies for the coming school year. And just this past year, I think over 1,100 kids were able to access backpacks and school supplies to start the upcoming school year. Under our strong communities focus area, 684 individuals received counseling support. And we had 93 families, including 177 children, that received support through wraparound. You know, it's often through this focus area that we support not just families, but seniors who are isolated or folks that need home care visits, things like that. We look at inclusion, social inclusion through this focus area. And this is Richard's story. A common story, especially given the demographics in Northumberland. When we look at folks who come to retire in this community, sometimes one of their a spouse dies and leaves the other widowed, and that can create confusion and a real need for support. And so this is Richard's story. He felt as though he wasn't able to carry on, but was able to access supports funded by United Way. Under our poverty to possibility focus area, 708 households in Northumberland County received support through the Salvation Army Christmas Hamper Program. 395 were assisted with intensive housing services, and 69 others were supported with rent geared to income applications through the Help Center. We were also able to support 895 nights of shelter to 53 individuals in our community. Often folks in our community have to choose between rent and food. And as a result, we created a pilot program with the County of Northumberland. And I'll sort of speak to that in just a moment here. So we have our own initiatives that we drive at United Way Northumberland as well. We support community programs that are presented by community partners, but we also have some of our programs that we sort of do, we deliver as a, as an agency. And so four of those are Period Promise, Northumberland Eats, Backpack for Kids, and Day of Caring. As I mentioned earlier, so many kids have been able to access this Backpack for Kids program. And since 2005, we've been able to distribute more than 17,000 backpacks. The past couple of years, we've added hand sanitizer and masks so that kids can be safe when they return to school. Day of Caring, unfortunately, we have not been able to have for the last couple of years just because of, you know, physical distancing and all of that. Was staying safe. Thankfully, our partners and our sponsors stepped up and donated funds in lieu of supporting Day of Caring so that we could take those funds and put them towards our COVID-19 relief fund. So huge thanks to all of those supporters. You may have heard of Northumberland Eats. It started as a pilot program last Christmas, and between Northumberland County and United Way Northumberland. And since then, over $70,000 in food vouchers have been invested into the community. And this pilot program came about as a result of really wanting to support people and allow them to access a hot meal, but also, and it is really a program for everyone, but also to support smaller businesses who had maybe been hit hard by closures in Northumberland County. It seems to be going well. It seems to be getting a really positive response. And so we are going to continue the program and hopefully for many years to come. So Port Hope is familiar with Period Promise. And this is an initiative that raises awareness about period poverty. And since we've started this initiative, over 7,000 menstrual hygiene products have been distributed to local individuals. We are also a certified organization, so that means anyone who visits our United Way will have access to free products in our washrooms and facilities. There is a more formal delegation. I'm under the understanding that it was sent along, so I'll just read that here as well. Northumberland United Way and Thrive Northumberland request council to adopt the following recommended action: that council recognizes members of its community experience financial barriers in accessing menstrual hygiene products, and further, that council support the work of Period Promise Northumberland by pledging its support to end period poverty in the municipality, and further, that council consider continuing the provision of free menstrual products in all municipal facilities as part of the 2022 budget deliberations. I understand that council has already done so much in this way, and our appreciation to you for that. 211 is a resource that you can access 24 hours a day, 7 days a week by going online to ontario211.ca or just by picking up the phone and dialing 211. And this initiative was created in response to helping people navigate the system. There are so many services that exist, but we were hearing that it was difficult to understand what was available and what the criteria was for eligibility and how to sort of get in touch with people. And so 211 is a way to do that. It's available in 150 languages. And it really is, it's a non-emergency number, but it's a number that people can call if they need support for social services. And that might look like direction around counseling services and other mental health services. It could look like food security, housing supports, income supports, those kinds of things. We are excited to say that we are a certified living wage employer. Last year, living wage was $18.06 an hour. And so I'm under the understanding that's changed a bit, and an announcement will be coming out soon around what living wage is in Northumberland this year. We are happy to say that we pay this to all employees at United Way. So our campaign message this year is, it's our time, what will you do now? And this comes from the idea that so much has changed and we've learned so much over the last 2 years. We've built momentum, worked a little bit differently, silver lining of COVID-19, being a bit of an agitator and forcing us to do things differently and look at things a bit differently. So, what are we going to carry forward from this time. It really is an opportunity for us to build on that momentum and continue the innovation that has been created over this time. So formally, North Northumberland United Way requests Council to the following recommended action: that Council recognizes the contributions of Northumberland United Way by pledging financial support to the annual campaign as part of the 2022 budget deliberations. And further, that Council consider running a United Way payroll campaign with Council and staff. And I understand this is something that you already do, so it's really just a reiteration of your work at this point. So thank you for that. If you'd like to understand more about what we do, or if you'd like to get in touch, here's our contact information, and you can follow us online. Thank you so much for your time, and I'm available for any questions.
Thank you, Bobby. I'm going to open up to Council for questions or comments. I think you've done a great job. I don't see any questions at this point in time. And I think as you did point out, you know, we do encourage our staff to participate, you know, on a regular basis, and that's entirely up them to do so. And I do believe we've also adopted as Council support for the period promise as well. So are there other questions or comments from Council? And our recommendation at this point in time is to receive this for information. And I would like to have a mover or a seconder or comments on that, recognizing that there were some specific requests from Bobby. All right, but and some of those are already, you know, being addressed. So I could have a, could I have a mover? Thank you, Deputy Mayor and Councillor Lees. Is there any further discussion about receiving this for information? Seeing none, I put it to the vote. Those in favor? Thank you. That's unanimous. Bobby, I can't thank you enough. We all know kind of what the work is doing and the workload that your group and yourself are carrying. So appreciate you coming to Council and giving us the update and for your time and energy. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
With that, I'm going to move on to the consent agenda, item 4. Right, and as I stated before, items listed under the consent agenda are considered routine in nature and are considered collectively as one motion. Council members may request that specific items be removed for separate discussion or deliberation and action. We have 3, 4.1, 2, and 3. Is any councillor want to remove any of these for further discussion? I don't see any. So 4.1 is Accessibility Advisory Committee meeting minutes of September the 9th, 2021. 4.2 is Heritage Port Hope Advisory Committee meeting minutes of July 19th, 2021. And 4.3 is a Special Heritage Port Hope Advisory Committee meeting minutes of September the 9th, 2021. And it's recommended to receive these for information as circulated. Do I have a mover, please? Moved by the Deputy Mayor, seconded by Councillor Meadows. Any further discussion? All those in favor? That's carried unanimously. I'm going to continue with the agenda and turn this meeting over to Corporate Services, Councillor Lees.
Mayor Sanderson, under Corporate Services, staff reports 5.11, Kate Ingram, Manager of Communications, regarding communications policy. We'd recommend that a resolution be presented to Council to adopt the communications policy, and that a bylaw be presented to Council to repeal bylaw 115-2007. Do I have a mover and a seconder, please? Moved by Deputy Mayor, seconded by Councillor Meadows. Any discussion on this? Councillor Carr?
Yeah, I'd just like to thank staff for this report. Proper brand management is so important to the credibility and the trust factor of an organization. And the items I pointed out on here of speaking in one voice and adhering to brand standards are really so critical. So thank you very much for creating this report. I think it's a terrific report, and it gives us a great guideline to follow. So thank you.
Great, thank you, Councillor Carr. Any other councillor have any anything to say on this? I'll ask the question, all in favor then? Thank you, that's unanimous. Does any other member of council have anything else for corporate services at this time? Seeing none, I will pass it on, and corporate services adjourned for the night, and we'll pass it on to finance and Councillor Carr. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Lees. Finance department is open. Staff reports 6.1.1. David Baxter, Director of Finance, regarding 2022 budget development initiation. David, I'd like to ask you if you would like to provide us with some guidance before we carry on with this.
Certainly, thank you, Councillor Carr. At our last meeting, we spoke just briefly about the upcoming budget and the types of feedback that we asked committee to give consideration to. I also mentioned that I would walk through the appendix, some of the considerations for the budget that we have outlined. So I am going to take a moment and share my screen here. Can someone just let me know if they can see my screen? It looks a little different for me now.
No, we can't. That's it.
There we go. Sorry, my screen appeared to have been frozen for a minute there. Okay, so this is, we're just going to start. This is just a bit of a model for consideration of what the 2022 budget could look like. So just starting off with the 2021 levy requirement. So that was just over $21 million. But for context, that means that any 1% change in the budget has an impact or results in an increase of $210,000. So some initial strategic considerations. The first is a development charge exemption contribution. And this stems from the 2019 development charges bylaw, which includes an exemption for the non-utility related charges for any new industrial property development. So this is really good for stimulating industrial growth, business development in our community, but it is required, right? The funds that we are exempting are then required to be funded by the municipality. And council passed a resolution to include those funds in our budget. It was estimated that the cost of this is on average, it will vary year over year depending on the level of development, but on average $250,000 per year. So we did have in last year's budget $89,000. So we have a ways to go. The suggestion this year, and this is the minimal, you know, suggestion, but on a minimal phased approach, is just to increase this $11,000. But what that does is at least gets us up to $100,000 in an annual contribution from our base levy. So it is a step in the right direction. And we've been able to meet, fund all of our incurred requirements to date. Further, we have the post-remediation reserve contribution. And this stems from the fact that the municipality is responsible for the risk management measures, monitoring and maintenance for the four industrial sites once remediated by the PHAI project. The first few years, the requirements are a lot higher, and combined for the first 5 years for all four sites, the estimate is about $800,000. It then comes down considerably to about $10,000 per year thereafter. So there will be an investment as part of this process that we suggest it's prudent to plan and contribute to a reserve so we can take the financial impact of that in a more of a phased approach. This is consistent with our mission, which includes environmental responsibility, and we're suggesting $100,000 to start as part of that phased approach. And also note that if we have funds in a reserve, the first priority would be the actual requirements from a risk management standpoint for those measures we're required to have from an environmental standpoint. But further funds would allow us to be able to then take some next steps on some of those properties. So that would certainly help from that aspect as well. So, then the third strategic consideration is an annual contribution from the tax levy for the community improvement plan. So council has made two contributions, but so far we do not have any recurring annual funding source. And council suggested the creation of an annual funding source in 2020. Thus far it has been deferred, but we're also the last update that we had in June on the CIP program identified that we have was about 60,000, so there will be less now available towards this program. And so the suggestion is so we can continue the program going into 2022 is to commence having an annual funding source from the tax levy. So for those three strategic considerations, and you'll note we are doing them in a phased approach, which is more minimal than me coming and asking for the full amounts, but they come in at about a 1% levy impact combined. Okay. Then we should have some consideration for impacts to our base budget, some general inflationary increases. I will note that the consumer price index or CPI is over 3% this year. Inflation is occurring, certainly as a municipality. We do experience that, and some of the construction side, we're experiencing more than that. However, in an effort to accommodate some of the strategic considerations and still mitigate the impact to the taxpayer, what we've included in our model is a 2% increase. So we'll see that, we see that here as well. We have used the same for both the police and library. This is a placeholder. As you know, we get our budgets from the boards, but we do expect that there will be an increase there as well. And so using a consistent increase, makes sense from a modeling standpoint. There is no recommended change to the contingency fund. So overall, the levy change that we're looking at is 3.6%, generating an additional $760,000. And then finally, I will note that we have the estimated amount that would be generated from new taxpayers or net growth. So think of this as a new home being built and a new homeowner contributing towards our municipal taxes. Taking and dedicating those funds towards the capital spending. And I will note that this is much needed to reduce our infrastructure funding deficit and fund, this would go towards in 2022. We have some key capital projects coming up, such as a rural roads program and hopefully being able to expand it. Several road reconstructions, such as Walton, Rose Glen, and Victoria. We have our Town Park Rec Center expansion, which we'll be continuing to progress through, as well as potentially a Lent Lane redevelopment pending a grant application. And that's just a sample of some of the larger projects that we do have. So that funding is much needed, but noting that that amount will be offset by the actual growth in the tax base. So our final municipal levy change remains at the $760,000 or 3.6%. For context, right, each 1% increase I noted before generates $210,000 in levy dollars. That impacts a typical homeowner with an increase to their bill of approximately $23 per 1% increase in the tax levy. I do note, just looking at our model as we have in prior years, right? This does not include any service level change recommendations. So any, you know, changes from our current, say, staff complement or expanding current services. And this is, just gives us a bit of an idea of what some of the challenges that we have going into the 2022 budget. So with that, I'll pass it over in a moment to Councillor Carr. From a staff perspective, we're looking for if there's identification of any other considerations that we should be aware of so that we can plan for that and have ready to show council what that looks like in advance of the meeting in December. Any specific items that should be identified to be included in a community consultation, and identify if there is a target for the municipal levy change. And I remind as you go through those discussions in that part, that we do require any direction to be formally given in the form of a motion. And then finally, with the adoption of the guidelines tonight, or the anticipation of them, we will set up a two-day special finance committee meeting to review and complete the 2022 budget in mid-December, as we have in the past years. So I'm stopped sharing. Hopefully you'll see that in a second. And Councillor Carr, I'll pass it back over to you and remain here if there's any questions.
Well, thank you very much for that, Director Baxter. That's very helpful. I know that we'll have some discussion on all of this, and I'd like to suggest that we do the discussion in this manner, where we discuss first what we would like to, additional items that we would like for inclusion into the budget, and out of those ones, what, if any, should be going forward for community consultation. And then finally, once we understand what those things are, what we're comfortable percentage-wise in recommending to staff to try and work within the budget. So I'll open the floor up for people to discuss anything else that they think would be appropriate for inclusion into this year's budget. And I'll start with you, Mayor Sanderson. You're on mute.
There you go, trying to take it up. Thanks, Director Baxter, for, I think, an overview that I think it's good, as you have noted, that it's not a recommendation, it's just information at this point in time. In addition to this, I think you asked all of council to participate and have some input. And I think many of us have, I know I have. And so from the perspective, and Councillor Carr, I'm asking you, how do you want to handle, you know, all that input? I know mine was broad and long and somewhat detailed, but the perspective I have on it is that our one of our goals is not just to reduce spending as much as it is to create revenues and deliver value for dollars. You know, and some of the input, I sort of say as maybe a bucket, with a lot of ideas, and hopefully, you know, counselors have all participated, because effectively all those ideas start to drive our strategic goals over a long term and not necessarily a short term. But if we approach that bucket as a separate entity and discuss some of the, you know, items that we would want to see moving forward strategically, then we can maybe prioritize those along our strategic goals as well. And I'm always cognizant that, you know, there is one taxpayer, and it's a common saying, but we have a municipal, you know, levy. The school board has their participation, and the county has theirs. And so I think we need to do due diligence on ours, but I guess I'm also encouraging us to think broader and deeper, looking at revenues and, you know, value that we put forward. And I say it only because some of the focus occasionally, and for other councils too, is really on scrimping and having a almost a negative, some municipalities that we want a zero tax increase. Those kind of things we should be cognizant of. But the request that was made, I hope all councillors have participated, creates a whole picture of things that would probably improve the municipality that may require, would require investment in many cases, some more or some less. But my question is, how are we going to handle that bunch of information that some of us have put in to meet sort of the requests that Director Baxter has, you know, put forward? It's not hard to be lean and mean and what have you. I think it's more difficult, you know, to deliver value and look at opportunities. And I always often equate it to, it's all very nice to put money in a savings account, but not if the family's starving and can't buy food. Sure. So we're in good shape overall. I think we're doing a fabulous job. And thank you for, you know, that committee. But I don't want to lose sight of that. We're a corporation. We need to invest in our residents, and we need to make the quality of life in Port Hope and put our values out there. And some of those are going to cost money besides the sort of the day-to-day absolute requirements. And sorry for rambling on, but I'm fairly passionate about spending money to help.
Well, and it's very important to do that, because as you mentioned, there is a quality of life that there's an expectation that our residents have that we will maintain. And consumer price index is up over 3% this year. I think it's around 3.5%. And you know, further to your point, to have a 0% increase means basically a 3.5% cut in service, which is not what we're here to do. So I think we need to prioritize the additions that we would like to have, the inclusions that we would like to have, and I do think we need to be a lot more creative about the additional revenue creation tools that we do have. And I know you, Mr. Mayor, had pointed out some information regarding parking that would do that, and that's absolutely one that comes to mind immediately. So I think collectively between the seven of us, there's a lot of creative minds here, and I think we can come up with some great ways also to generate some revenue for the municipality as well. So what I'd like to do is try and find if there are some specific inclusions that people are really passionate about. I know that there's a few laundry lists out there that we've got, but there must be some things that people are more passionate about than others. And you know, hopefully we can start chipping away at them. So Yes, Mayor Sanderson.
I'm quite in line with what you're saying. It just would be nice if we can compile everybody's input. You know, it's kind of like a whiteboard, you know, and then I'd like to look at everybody else's, you know, input as well. And then out of that, you know, it could be 100 things that we want to see done. I would tend to prioritize them based on our strategic goals and depending on, you know, departmental priorities. So then we could say, okay, so how does that list from 100 go to what are your top ones? And then perhaps we could have a discussion on that. Some of them may be like spending a bit of money on the dog park. It's okay to say we have a dog park, but it could be a better dog park than it is. You know, and I use it only as a minor thing. We have Memorial Park that's, you know, really, we've seen when movies come in, how it comes to life. You know, we have King's Field languishing. And so when those things go into sort of the master list, they're not for me about this year, right? It's about, are these important things that we should be keeping our eye on and moving forward, you know, and if we have, you know, funds allocated to the bucket, so to speak, then I think we could, in fact, you know, start to strengthen our strategic goals and that quality of life. It takes a while. There's a huge movement on, whether it be, you know, climate management, environmental stuff. It's got a lot of focus. And if we pick things that really are kind of, that the government would like to fund, I guess, actually, quite simply, then we should prioritize places we can get funding. Because the index going up 3% is fine, but I suspect if you talk to our director of public works, the project that would we do this year is not going to go up by 3% next year. It's going to go up significantly more. Okay. So I think the consumer price index is something I'm very cautious about following, you know, because it doesn't feel real. It doesn't certainly apply to me. I haven't seen that happen. See, costs go up a lot more somehow on that basis. So from the municipal perspective, it's nice to look at it, but I'm not guided by it so much. So back to the original thing, can we compile all the input from all of council, you know, tie it to our strategic plan and then have some maybe feedback? We can do that, you know, kind of virtually. And anybody who hasn't contributed should.
We can certainly do that. That won't provide any of the direction that Director Baxter's hoping for at this point in time. It won't provide it now. It will certainly delay that. But you know, there is an opportunity to, as you say, whiteboard it and see if there's any consistency to the you know, to the ideas that are out there.
Just as follow up and not to belabor this, we can still, you know, conduct ourselves in accordance with what, you know, our director has asked for, you know, with respect to those. But without having everybody's input, I think it's hard to say, well, we think a public meeting should be here or there on certain items. I think the important ones like the community improvement plan are evident. But I find it, in going through it, you know, a little bit of a challenge to sort of pick one. If quite frankly, if I picked one, I do think, you know, we need more human resource in some areas, you know, and certainly from a management perspective and in talking to some staff and some of the directors, our senior managers are handling what, you know, other people should manage. And I don't see that under discussion. And certainly, even from a county council perspective and issue papers, it's very important to apply increased staff resources when necessary, if you show they're necessary. You know, but I certainly see in the last while, you know, from our, you know, staffing perspective, we have a lot to do, and we'll get more done if we can manage this area a little bit. And again, it's a challenge. I'm not trying to delay it. I think it's an additional component of what's being asked for. We've all put this in, you know, but it's also hard to say, well, here's the four things, you know, that we maybe, you know, should consider as, you know, a requirement to put in now for, as an example, public meetings. I prefer, quite frankly, just to say we're going to probably need 2 public meetings. I don't know what they're going to be on yet, but we'll need to have some, you know, funding and identification of where we do need them. So again, I'm going to go back to have that. How can I get that list of everybody's? And I'll be happy to roll up my sleeve and put some priorities on it. I hope everybody else would too.
Thank you, Mayor.
Not to delay the next steps by HHS.
Deputy Mayor, you had some comments?
Yeah, I sort of come from a different angle. I saw the list that the mayor and some of the councillors have put together. It's very, very comprehensive. And, you know, there is a bit of wish list stuff in there, and that there is some good things that we should be doing to enhance our future. And I think that if we were willing to commit, and I'm only using this as a figure because it's an easy number, if we are willing to commit 1% of our tax levy to interest, that we could borrow $5-6 million to get things done. Things aren't going to get any cheaper in the future. So if we want to do things, we should be executing now, depending on the staff resources that we have. And that's going to be a challenge. So I think we have to balance what we want with what we can actually get done with the staff that we have that we're going to have to hire and the ability to hire, and then make a commitment that instead of living hand to mouth year after year and just trying to exist on increasing the levy and try and fund one or two little things to bite the bullet and borrow some real significant money to get some significant things done. And, you know, we know that our future is going to be there, that, you know, the Mason homes are coming on stream, and we're going to have that amount of money coming in the future, so we can balance it. We can come up with spreadsheets to see what the impact of borrowing $5 or $10 million would be if we think we can accomplish the goals with the staff, and that is a big if. Thank you.
Yes, you're absolutely right. The resources are not just financial resources, they're also human resources. So we have to balance both. Any other comments from any other members of council? Okay, I'm not seeing any. So possibly the way we should continue with this then is prepare the kind of whiteboard kind of idea that the mayor is talking about. Everybody have their input onto it. And, you know, come up with the top few priorities, get an understanding of the costing of that from both a financial and human resources perspective, and then balance that with, if we have the human resources for it, then take a look at how it would work if we were to borrow some of the money to go ahead and accomplish some projects, because there's certainly a long list of things that council's interested in doing, and certainly all of the items are coming to council from our residents, and so the interest here is what our residents are interested in having, and you know, potentially what the deputy mayor is suggesting is maybe another alternative as to how we deal with this. So maybe I would suggest at this time that we have everybody from council please submit your requests. Not everybody has chimed in yet, and I'm sure you all have some pet projects that your residents have been discussing with you, and we will create that whiteboard and get it out and get it prioritized and get it priced. Is that comfortable with the majority of council here, Ms. Mayor Sanderson?
Yep, I appreciate that. I think that is constructive. My only comment would be, when you look at the list, it's not a list for this year, right?
Absolutely.
It's kind of tying our strategic plan and our departmental priorities to a longer term strategy, so we can say, we have that on our list, like any requirement. It may be 2 or 3 years, but we shouldn't lose it.
Yes, CAO Smith.
Yeah, thank you very much, Chair Carr and staff for listening diligently, of course, and will help facilitate Council's direction in this. And the only thing that I would also remind Council is that we do have a number of departmental plans. I know that's been mentioned. So Council just received a Leisure Services Master Plan that has some of these aspirational projects already identified, already have been through a public process, have already been vetted by Council. So I think there's an opportunity to mesh the two, and maybe it's receiving Council's suggestions and Council's priorities and combing through them and discovering which ones are aligned with the plans that we have in place, so that we don't have two processes going at once. And certainly some of the ideas won't be in master plan, and that doesn't mean that we can't do them. I think it would just be helpful to identify the ones that are already identified in plans.
Makes total sense. Any other comments? Deputy Mayor?
Yeah, I know that borrowing always puts a bit of stiffness in people's backs, and what if everything goes to in a handbasket in the future for the economy? But if you look back historically, the only cities, municipalities, and mainly in the States that got into trouble was mainly over labor costs. So we have to be very cognizant of what we do going forward for all staff in terms of, where is the labor cost line going? And we better, be very cognizant that not everybody shared the same shared the same pain through COVID. Some shared a lot of pain, and some shared none. And so I think that has to be reflective in how we look at labor costs going forward.
Yes, that's absolutely true. Not everybody had the same COVID experience, for sure. I would... Councillor Bank, did you have a comment?
Thank you. Yes, I just want to clarify the discussion we're having right now. Are we actually putting together a laundry list at this moment, or are we doing this separately and coming back? And then some of the items that I would consider a priority, as the CAO had mentioned, and Director Baxter had mentioned as well, some of the ones that I have on my laundry list. So going through this exercise right now of listing things, they may have already been identified. So I'm just a little bit confused as to, are we doing this now, or are we submitting this in another forum some way and coming back to this?
We're submitting this in another forum and coming back to this. Any other comments? Okay, I would ask Director Gilmer for some recommendations on how we move forward with this.
Yeah, I thank you, Madam Chair. Just with respect to the recommendation or the motion coming out of this, I did just miss the last 2 minutes of conversation. I'm sorry for that. But it sounds like Council is looking to undertake an effort to have individual members of Council identify specific items for consideration in the 2022 budget. So my recommended, and this is subject to the chair's ruling and certainly subject to a member of council wanting to move this, but I think if I can capture a recommended motion, it might look something like a committee received the guidelines and timelines outlined in this report for information and direct staff to prepare the 2022 operating capital budget. And further, that individual members of council undertake an exercise to identify specific budget priorities for consideration and send those to staff for consolidation and consideration at a later date. Catch all that?
I think that pretty much sums it up, and I think the later date needs to be within a week. And based on what Director Gilmer is recommending, is council comfortable with that process? Deputy Mayor?
I wouldn't mind, just having a brainstorming session with council and getting some of these ideas out on the table and then prioritizing the ones that we think we can actually get to and laying it out a little bit in a neater format for staff, because as our CAO mentioned, there's a lot of initiatives that are already out there that we may have just repeated in our lists, and mm-hmm. and it may be a better way of shortening the process, because the two-day session with the budget meetings, that gets a little hard to do with that. That should be a pretty rapid process as opposed to a thinking process. We should be doing the thinking in advance, and whether we can call a special council meeting or something like that.
Absolutely, we should be doing it in advance of those 2 day meetings. So I'm certainly prepared to have discussion with any council members who are interested in providing some different inclusions that they would like in the budget. I think we need to consolidate it and send it off to CAO Smith, and he would advise us from there what has already been identified through things like the leisure guide, as he mentioned, and what would be independent inclusions. Yes, CAO Smith.
Yeah, Chair Carr, I'd like to suggest, I think Director Gilmer's motion gives us some latitude and gives council some flexibility, staff can regroup based on that and suggest the process for council to follow, when to submit, how to submit it, where to submit it, and then the Director Baxter could work with you as chair on how we facilitate that discussion and that prioritization process. And on top of all of that, we can integrate the part about plans that are already there. So I guess what I'm suggesting is, if we follow the motion put forth by the clerk, I think it's sufficient for us to get going in tomorrow or the next day and get the process out for council.
If it's of any of assistance, Madam Chair, I can share my screen just so council members are clear on the wording I had shared.
That would be great if you could, please. Thank you. And can I get a mover and a seconder for this revised motion? Moved by Mayor Sanderson, seconded by Councillor Lees. Any further discussion? Mayor Sanderson?
Just to encourage everybody to throw everything into that think tank, as the deputy mayor was saying, I don't think we need to have the meeting for it. But if it's there, and then staff can and the finance committee could look through and perhaps tie it into current activities, I think that would help. Certainly on my list, I put a lot of maybe smaller items that aren't necessarily appropriate at this point in time for the budget. But I think from a strategic overview long term, the things I want to take note of. So this is I think a very good motion, and I totally obviously move it and support it with just those comments. That's all. Let's get the master list. I'd like to see what everybody's thinking.
Thank you. Any other comments? Okay. Then I will ask, all in favor? And that's unanimous. We'll move on to new business and provide you the library update. The week of October 17th to 23rd is Ontario Public Library Week. This is a time when libraries invite the community to come in to discover and explore what lies behind the front desk of the library. On October 20th at 1 p.m., visit the library's social media or website for an online interview with Northumberland County author Linda Metzel Manning, as she talks about her memoir, Fearless and Determined, 2 years teaching in a one-room school. Tim Jeffries, dinosaur expert, will be appearing at the Hub Branch at Canton on Saturday, October 23rd at 1 p.m. Tim brings his expertise and real specimens to inform and entertain, suitable for ages 7+. Vaccination certificates are required, and call Port Hope Public Library or email loleary@phpl.ca to pre-register. Together We Read Ontario runs from October 18th to 31st. This year's selection is Frying Plantain. Check out the novel either as an ebook or audiobook without waitlists or holds on Libby. Visit togetherweread.com/CA to download book discussion questions. PHPL also has a print copy for loan. An invitation is extended to anyone who has relocated recently to Port Hope to join New Peeps in the Port to chat about life in our community. Join the staff in Rotary Park, just south of the Mary J. Benson Branch, on October 24th at 10:30. Bring your own lawn chair and your own beverage. Effective October 25th, 2021, there will be a new schedule at Mary J. Benson Branch. Mondays from 10 a.m. to 8 p.m., Tuesday to Thursday from 10 to 5, Friday 10 till 2, and Saturday 10 till 2. And we, staff at the library, hope to reopen the Hub Branch very soon. And with that, that's the end of finance for tonight. And I will turn things over to Deputy Mayor Andrews.
Thank you, Councillor Carr, and good spirited conversation on the budget. Community development is now open. Staff report 7.11. We have a presentation by Lauren Millier of MDB Insight and a staff report from Tom Dodds, Director of Community Development, regarding the Community Development Service Delivery Review results. And Director Dodd, would you care to introduce Lauren to us?
Thank you very much, Deputy Mayor Andrews, and good evening, everyone. I'm pleased to introduce MDB Insights Executive Vice President Lauren Millier. Before I get into sort of a bit of a background on her, and I thought I would just sort of cover off some key points of the project and what we're trying to do today. We're going to provide an overview of the service delivery report that she and her team prepared. A full report will be posted onto our website, but tonight's efforts are sort of to get to sort of the heart and provide a quick overview of the project, and as well as sort of get into a bit of detail about the recommendations as well. By way of background, and the reason we selected Lauren is she has a planner by training, has had extensive experience in economic development, and the combination of two we thought was quite an appropriate choice for the work that she was undertaking. And so, that kind of experience, plus having being part of and a founder of a leading firm in economic development, we thought it was a nice fit. And so without going any further, Lauren, I'm going to pass it over to you. And I'm assuming, and correct me if I'm wrong, you have, Lauren has the ability to do her own slides, or would you like someone to do it for you?
As long as I have access, I can share my slides.
Terrific. Thank you.
I'm having some internet difficulties, so I'm going to stop my video while the presentation is on. And I'll turn it back on when I'm finished. Bear with me. Can everyone see the slides okay? All right, we're good. So thank you for providing me with the opportunity. Mr. Dobbs has said our firm completed the Community Development Service Delivery Review on behalf of the Municipality of Port Hope. And the one thing I do want to point out that we had another partner in this exercise as well, and that was RFA Planning out of Belleville. Both Spencer Hutchison, who is a former planner with Port Hope, and Ruth Ferguson also supported the work that was undertaken, particularly as it relates to the review of the delivery of planning services in the municipality. Just so everyone understands, and I'm hoping you've had an opportunity to look at the report, but just for the benefit of everybody on the call, the project outcomes for this were intended to address improved service delivery and customer service through the use of online tools, applications, and data management. The municipality was also looking to understand business process mapping for both public and municipal employees. We were to look at service delivery analytic tools and methodologies to evaluate Port Hope's business processes in support of development. Also consider customer feedback processes and targeted community services and engagement to assess the effectiveness of service delivery strategies. We were also looking to accommodate new and increased development demand for development services and help to reduce cost and improve time efficiency through improved customer service across the department. One of the things that I think is particularly important to point out, and it's certainly factored into some of the thinking around the recommendations in the report, and that is consideration around the growth projections for the community. Obviously, when we look at population and employment, it's an indicator of expected level of growth, and important to understand the capacity that may be required in the months and years to come to accommodate both the population and employment growth that is being projected. Based on information that was provided to us through the work that Watson's done on your behalf, we understand that there will be a 30% increase in population, resulting in much more complex development applications, as opposed to perhaps traditionally what has been single family and greenfield development. We anticipate a lot more mixed use and infill development applications in order to accommodate this projected level of growth. We also anticipate an employment increase of upwards to 1,300 positions over the next 30 years. And this will need to be accommodated on shovel-ready employment lands or in some of the commercial core areas around the municipality. Another factor that is also, I would suggest, influenced some of the recommendations in the report is the implications of COVID-19. Certainly in our experience with other municipalities and in information and literature that we are looking at all the time with respect to the impact of COVID, it has accelerated the challenges for municipalities to deliver vital services to residents, and it's also drawn attention to the need to modernize local services. So the methodology in terms of how this work was completed, we obviously undertook a review of community development activities and current programming. We did a background review that detailed the role and function of the department. And we also engaged all of your staff so that we had a thorough understanding of where they were currently involved and to where they saw some of the limitations that they were experiencing in the delivery of their job descriptions of their functions within the department. Other aspects of the stakeholder engagement, we reached out to members of council, reached out to senior staff, your committee chairs, as well as your external partner organizations to get their perspective on service delivery within planning, within economic development, and also within land and building services. Having completed that portion of the work, another key consideration was how we benchmark Port Hope relative to what other communities were doing. And with input from the community development staff, as well as RFA planning, we selected Belleville, Brockville, and Coburg, and we examined both their planning and their economic development services, including staff levels, programming delivery, and comparable capacity, I would suggest, in terms of the type of planning applications that they were delivering, but also the complexity of their economic development services. All of this then has informed the recommendations and the reporting and the draft final report that is with you now. We believe it's an evidence-based report on how to improve service delivery, how to address your organizational structure, staffing requirements, and it also gives consideration to how best to integrate technology and the deployment of enhanced communication tools across the municipality and an interdepartmental level, but also external into your residents and business community. The report also includes relevant KPIs, and we've differentiated between planning and development and economic development for obvious reasons. Part of the report that is in front of you also comprises a SWOT analysis. And this is a summary of observations, perspectives, as well as the input and information that we collected through our background review. Some of this won't come as a big surprise to you. Other aspects of it might. Certainly when we examine the strengths of the municipality, we see very strong population growth trends. We see dedicated staff focused on supporting community development. We also see the integration of technology-based tools. And we would note, since this work was completed in March, that the municipality has been able to move forward with a number of the recommendations that were in the report or build on actions that were underway through the work we were doing. We also see a good base of partnerships in place, certainly in looking at the capacity and the requirements for delivering planning and development and economic development in Port Hope. We recognize that the municipality will need partners in order to make this happen, and we acknowledge the partners that are in the municipality now, as well as some of the regional partners that you've also got in place. Some of the weaknesses, however, also stem from the structural gaps that we exceed in the department's performance. There are gaps in administrative support that affect customer service, Certainly observations on our part with input from staff that there is a lack of training and a coordination and communication of roles within the department. We also observed some pretty significant technology gaps affecting service delivery and municipal competitiveness. And we say that in relation to what other municipalities are doing, as well as the observations and input that we had from staff. And as well, one of the things that came through much of the consultation was the perception that the municipality lacks a long-term economic vision of the community. And this has an impact long-term over the planning and development, as well as the economic development performance. Some of the opportunities that were identified was building staff capacity to improve planning and development service delivery performance. And certainly there are tools and processes out there, and we see this in the best practice work that we looked at. But there are some easy tools to move forward with, and some fairly low-hanging fruit, I believe, for the municipality in terms of how we can go about trying to improve service delivery in the short term. We also think that there's an opportunity to better define the role of economic development and to integrate tools and techniques that will improve service delivery and promote planning initiatives that will support growth and investment. Some of the larger threats that we believe need to be addressed, and again, our recommendations speak to some of this, is the community challenges that may affect growth and development. And some of this is just there is a quarter of the municipality that doesn't want to see much change and doesn't want to see significant growth and development impact what they believe is a heritage and strong quality of place community. There's also varying regional and provincial priorities that could present challenges, and I don't think we need to look too much further than what the province requires of the municipality in terms of places to grow and what that will mean for the municipality as well, and the priorities that emerge regionally in terms of the collaboration that may be required with the County of Northumberland. Certainly in terms of the organizational structure and the recommendations that are in the plan, we've tried to draw some fairly clear alignment of the community development accountabilities with your strategic priorities. We believe that a refocused organizational structure with an enhanced priority for economic development is also a prudent move at this point. We also see investment in planning capacity using current approved funding, and this is the funding that's being provided through the province in order to expedite some of the development approvals that municipalities are trying to manage. And we also see the need for increased connectivity between planning and building. And you'll see when we get to the recommendations around organizational structure, how we see that playing out. We also think it's worth pointing out that you currently have an FTE equivalent of 10 people, and the changes that are being recommended in the report propose 11, subject to budget approval. We have used current vacancies to implement the recommendations, and we've also suggested in the report that you follow standard HR practices and policies to ensure clarity on new and revised job descriptions, performance expectations, and also a matching of skill sets. So this is the proposed organizational structure that is in the report. And you can see how we have transitioned aspects of the department. We show the integration of your building department along with your chief building official, building inspector, bylaw enforcement officer, as well as a customer service assistant. We've also introduced a manager of economic development and a manager of planning and strategic initiatives, and a realignment of some of the other positions within the community development department as well. In terms of the implications this has for staffing, and we have suggested there be a manager of planning and strategic initiatives, and this individual focus on managing and administering the municipal land use policy and planning, but it will also oversee the management of strategic community development priorities and initiatives. And this will be intentional growth and affordable housing. One of the obvious implications there is an update to your official plan. We've also suggested that you use the vacant strategic development coordinator position to fund a senior planner position, and that you hire a trained and experienced heritage planner. This individual should be able to help with the existing workload, provide knowledge of the specific field of planning that relates to heritage planning. And I would note that one of the rationale for this is simply the inventory of heritage buildings that the municipality has and the commitment that it's made to retaining and enhancing those properties as part of your urban fabric. We also think too that it should be all acknowledged that this expertise it's difficult to recruit, and it does require somebody with quite a specialized background. We've also suggested that you refocus your marketing and tourism division to economic development. And this will continue to include tourism, filming, and investment attraction activities. But with the introduction of a manager of economic development, we see this individual as overseeing the creation and implementation of an economic development strategy, as well as developing, managing, and implementing programs and services that will be identified as part of that strategy. We also think this individual can increase opportunities for non-residential growth and how best to drive high-value, high-quality employment in the municipality. And certainly, it's part and parcel of that conversation is the need for additional service employment land and the opportunities associated with investment attraction on those lands. But it isn't just industrial development. As the municipality moves toward a more service-based economy, it's how to grow your commercial component of your economy as well. We've also suggested a shift in focus of the business outreach coordinator position and realign this as an economic development coordinator focused on business retention and expansion, as well as your community improvement programming. And this individual would report directly to the manager of economic development on an ongoing basis. The report also talks at great length around some of the performance improvements, and I won't go into a lot of these in great detail, but certainly instituting a framework to pre-screen the planning and development pre-consultation meetings requests of staff. This was something that we saw in a number of municipalities. It means when we've asked you to attend meetings, that there is input that we're looking for, and staff have an understanding that's when they're asked to attend, it is a priority for them to attend these meetings. We've also suggested that you undertake a comprehensive review of the current approach to processing and reviewing development applications and give consideration to creating what we would call a priority path for some high value projects. This is something we see in other municipalities as well, and there's some really good benchmarks out there, I would suggest, for the municipalities should it decide to go that route. We've also suggested that you explore opportunities to improve staff's capacity, recognizing that across the board, the input that we received for staff that are currently in these positions, they're held in very high regard. But in discussing with them what they felt their limitations were, it was certainly in professional development, more management and leadership training, that would assist them both in capacity as well as the mentoring that they need to do with existing staff. And then lastly, and I think probably equally as important, is the role and relationship the municipality has both with the Chamber and the Heritage BIA, and doing a direct contract with both of them to manage the Visitor Information Center and Visitor Guide. And obviously a lot of this also has behind it a broad range of KPIs in order to understand that you are in fact getting the outcomes you're looking for with these process improvements. We've also suggested a number of improvements to technology or how best to leverage technology. Certainly upgrading the municipality's GIS platform and software to allow more convenient access within the organization, and particularly within the planning and building department or planning and development department, and also to explore the feasibility of online information technology tools and market intelligence platforms that allow you to deliver your services more effectively, but also engage with your public, your residents, around the effectiveness of some of the programs and service delivery aspects of the department. We've also recognized as part of the work that we've done, that resources need to be provided to ensure that your planning documents and applications are all AODA compliant and available online. And again, this is one of those things in looking at the implications of COVID. All of these technology considerations are all being considered by municipalities across the province, I would suggest, to one degree or another. So I'm going to pause there and I will stop my share and I will turn my video on. And I would welcome any questions on your part.
Before we get to the questions, could I recommend we receive this report for information purposes? A mover and a seconder, please. Moved by Councillor Mink and seconded by Councillor Bickle. Okay, now I will take any questions, concerns, except from Director Dodds. Director Dodds, you're on mute.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor Andrews. And I apologize if I sounded extraordinarily loud on the conversation to start. I didn't appreciate that, so you those that have to turn their volumes down, I tried turning mine down. I just a couple of things to add. First of all, thank you very much, Lauren. That was a lot to go through. And I know you're getting it, folks, with both barrels, and appreciate that. I think a couple of key points. First of all, this was undertaken in March with some updates in September. So a number of things have transpired since then in terms of activity and some of the decision-making. In fact, the org chart that was provided to you, some movement has already occurred. Clearly, when we look at these recommendations, Lauren is providing her best advice and independent advice on what she has seen based on her review of both our municipality and others. And I think it's very valuable as a reference point. I think the key thing is that we're going to take this back. I think we should probably report back on the recommendations that were provided and give you a sense of the direction. Many of them we can implement or already are implementing on our own, but there's others that are going to require direction and support from council. And so I think that this is a really good tool to use as a reference point. And similarly, we can use the full report as a means of guiding us going forward. So I thank Lauren very much for that. It was a compressed time frame in which we prepared this, but there was a great level of collaboration, and I think we quickly got on the same page. So without saying any further, I'm happy to, for myself or particularly Lauren, to answer any questions.
Questions? Discussion? Let's start with Mayor Sanderson.
Obviously, we're approaching our budget time. So this sort of a report, is going to be hopefully considered within the, budget moving forward, which we just sort of went through. Because there's quite a few recommendations that I think require, some sort of financial investment. And are those coming forward through the budget process from your department, and are they to some degree being allowed for, recognizing that we don't have approval for a lot of it at this point in time? So I love the report. There's a lot of stuff in there I think we have to have action on, and I'll obviously leave that to our CAO, but that's what he's going to do, right? And coming back with recommendations, I'm just a little bit, or want some confidence that we're not overlapping on the budget. I would like to make sure that we can implement certainly strong recommendations, and that council would support those, and that they would have obviously a budget impact.
If I may, if that's right, through the chair to Mayor Sanderson, and this is my comments. I'm sure that the CAO might very well have some comments as well. First of all, in this, we've gone through it, and what I'd like to sort of the report back I would like to provide is, as I think I indicated, a lot of these or a number of these recommendations can be done without any budget impact. And some we may choose not to do for and provide the rationale why at this particular point in time. I'm going to get too far ahead of myself, but there's some organizational recommendations that perhaps are quite appropriate for council to consider in a longer term time frame. There's some we can implement now and some we can implement later. So that's one. Second thing, though, I think there's some very specific ones that we've already discussed with, I've discussed with the CAO and with finance staff that we would like to be bringing forward this year, but they are mindful that, you know, we have a limited amount of funds. And so we think that there are prudent ones and ones that in the report have been strongly recommended. For example, coming with an economic development strategy, we think that I know is very important to have as kind of a fundamental guide in both in the redevelopment of that capacity and then also where our priorities might lie. I don't know if there's anything further you would like to add, but I think Mr. Smith is good.
Okay. I would just like to follow up and just add, I think, you know, certainly from my own perspective and council, you know, it's very important that we, you know, get the job done and the service delivery is in keeping with the expectations. And I guess what I'm simply saying is I wouldn't want the budget to stand in the way of doing a better job.
Thank you. We will certainly take that in consideration.
I have a couple things I wouldn't mind asking. Lauren, first of all, thank you. It was a great report. There's a lot of elements in there. In your estimation of the three case studies you looked at, Belleville, Coburg, and who was the other one? I'm sorry.
Rockville.
I'm sorry?
Belleville, Brockville, and Coburg.
Are any of them doing a really, really super job on economic development, in your estimation?
Brockville, I think, is doing a really excellent job at economic development. Coburg has been in a bit of a transition. Belleville has been in a bit of a transition. I think Brockville is just a little bit further ahead in understanding its needs with respect to employment lands. They are moving forward with the servicing of additional lands. They are moving forward with some very strong partnership arrangements with the expansion on the hospital, the attraction of long-term care facilities, senior housing. They're in a regional consortium to try and bring investment attraction to the 401 corridor. They've just done their tourism strategy, which is looking at how to drive more economic impact as it relates to their tourism sector as well. So I would suggest of the three, I would probably identify Brockville ahead of Belleville.
Okay, thank you. The second question I have is that on your org chart, you have a dotted line to Northumberland County and CFDC as being resource. Why?
Yes. We wanted to ensure in looking at the organizational structure that we recognize that all three of those dotted line organizations have resources and capabilities at their disposal. They're also active partners with you. We know that the Heritage BIA, as I mentioned earlier, and the chamber are both active in your downtown and in support of your business improvement area. And the relationship with Northumberland Economic Development, if there are regional initiatives that are being driven, I think it's important that Port Hope not only be at the table with what the county is doing, but you also be engaging more effectively with the county around some of the regional economic development activity. One prime example I would suggest, and I know that the county is also considering what else, but the county right now has a pretty significant agricultural agenda, and it's not just in support of the growth and sustainability around farming, but also trying to drive innovation and entrepreneurship associated with agriculture and agribusiness. And those types of business activities will look for employment land or industrial land or dry industrial lands, and they're going to exist in a number of municipalities as opposed to some of the rural areas. So certainly Port Hope has a role to play there. I also think there's an opportunity to drive a larger discussion around investment attraction for the 401 corridor municipalities and do that in conjunction with Northumberland County's economic development.
Okay, well, I take when you say active participation, I don't believe we do have active participation with either the Northumberland County or with the CFTC. With CFTC, we have had some engagement, but that was predicated on us reaching out to them and not the other way around. And similarly within Northumberland County, in my estimation, they have not done much for us. Anyways, that's just me. And
if I may, both of those organizations participated in our interviews, and both of them have recognized that they need to be stronger partners with respect to economic development and planning.
Not only for us, but for all the communities within there.
I would agree.
Yep. Yes. Sorry, I don't want to monopolize this. Comments from the other councils? No. Okay. Seeing none. Thank you very much. We have
Thank
a lot
you.
To do. Oh, one last question. In your org chart, yes. You say go from 10 to 11. Is that enough people? Are we going to be able to accomplish what we need to with just 11 people?
I believe you will. Yes, based on the experience, I mean, obviously, there's always the opportunity to look at adding additional staff as you need it. But I think if we're looking at the current capacity of planning to manage the planning approvals that you're dealing with now, one of the biggest challenges there is the they are working at capacity trying to manage development applications and lack the capacity to do some of the long-range planning and visioning that is required. So adding a manager of planning and strategic initiatives would certainly help with that. And I believe adding a planning assistant as well would further support that department. And certainly in looking at the manager of economic development, the report goes into what we would anticipate as a the set of skill requirements and the years of experience in working in both of these areas. And certainly I think if staff were in place that had that experience, you would probably find that you were better able to deal with some of the capacity issues you've got.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Bye-bye.
Bye. If there's no further discussion, all those in favor of accepting the recommendation? That's carried. 7.1.2, Mandy Court, Administrative Assistant, Community Development Secretary Treasurer, Committee of Adjustments regarding B02-21 Consent Agreement. 8010 Stonehouse Road, recommend that a bylaw be presented to Council to execute an agreement between the Municipality of Port Hope and Robert Armstrong, property owner of 8010 Stonehouse Road, for the purpose of satisfying a condition of consent application B02-21. I have a mover and a seconder, please. Moved by Councillor Bickle, seconded by Councillor Meadows. Any discussion on this? Seeing none, all those in favor? Thank you. 7.1.3, Theodore Romero Pace, manager planning regarding Aon Inc. plans of subdivision. It's the extension of draft plan request. The applicant RDL and Plan Consultants Inc. on behalf of Aon Inc. recommend that a resolution be presented to council to extend the draft approval for the Ferguson Farm Northeast and Ferguson Farm Northwest plans of subdivision within the Aon Inc. lands from the lapsing provisions contained within the Ontario Municipal Board approved decisions by an additional 3 years. Can we get this on the table? They have a mover and a seconder. Moved by Councillor Meadows, second by Councillor Mink. Theodora, would you care to give us a few words on this?
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. So this is a request that has come from the consultant on behalf of Aon. And this request is to extend the draft plan approval, the lapsing provision from December 31st, 2021 for another 3 years. And this is only for the plans of subdivision north of the Lakeshore Road. And these are draft plans that have been approved in 2003, 2005 by the Ontario Municipal Board. And they were approved initially for 3 years and have been extended 4 times since. And I wanted to note that this request has not, it will not alter any applications for the phase 5B or phase 5A. They are under the Ontario Land Tribunals, and the draft conditions for the phase 5A were approved in May this year. And I wanted also to add that Ontario Land Tribunal still has jurisdiction on this two draft plan of subdivision north of Lakeshore Road. And if the council approves this request, then the consultant will submit the resolution from the council, and then the tribunal will extend the 3-year lapsing provision.
Thank you. Does anybody have any questions for Theodora? Councillor Carr?
Yeah, I'm wondering why we would be extending something that's already been extended 4 times. And so I'd like to know what the reasoning is behind the extensions, firstly. And secondly, I'd like to know what the OMB conditions are that are in this agreement. It's... you know, if this is something that's been going on since 2003, this is what seems to get us into problems with this group, is things just keep getting extended and delayed and extended and delayed. Yet when we don't need a timeline, we're taken right to the LPAT right away. So, you know, somewhere along the line, when you have a relationship, there's got to be some reciprocity, and I'm not seeing any here. So I'm not personally comfortable in doing an extension until I have a lot more information.
Thank you.
Through the chair to Councillor Carr, the draft condition that have been approved by the OMB in 2003 and 2005, it's a list of conditions talking about the technical study that has to be completed by the proponent. And then one of the conditions is that it will expire in 3 years. And this is what we're extending. The approval by the OMB at the time was on a block based, and it was in terms of the uses. You know, there are some institutional uses for the retirement home. There are some low density uses and the high density uses, and also open space uses as well. So that was kind of high level, and that's how the Ontario Municipal Board approved all the draft plan of subdivision at the time. And that was through an agreement with the municipality. The municipality at the time was part of that agreement with the OMB. But I will be more than happy to provide you with a list of conditions. and we can have that discussion offline as well in the condition. Also, if we needed to, I know Shannon Seguin is on the line, and if we needed to ask some questions to her, we can invite her as well to the table if the chair desires so.
How would you like to proceed? Okay. Councilor Carr, what do you think?
I personally need a lot more documentation before I can approve this. That's
how time sensitive is this?
In terms of, you know, the Ontario Land Tribunal need to make a decision, my understanding is by December 31st for the extension. So our experience over the past five extension is it has come to council. That resolution has been passed to the applicant and then they take it to the Ontario Land Tribunal. Also, I would like to note that if we were to refuse that, still the jurisdiction is with the tribunals to approve or to deny that lapse in provision.
So how do you want to proceed? Mayor Sanderson, you're on mute.
Just want to be clear that the Theodore and the staff is recommending that council approve this. Is that correct?
Through the chair, yes, to the Mayor Sanderson.
Director Dodds?
I just would add that this, what this is, and you please correct me if I'm wrong, Theodora, the council is being asked to endorse something before it goes to the OLT. So, I mean, the point I think the Theo is making, it can go forward even though we have not endorsed it. In other words, we have been given the opportunity to endorse it. If council chooses not to, it goes back to OLT for discussion at that point. But it will, because what they've asked us to do is to endorse it. If council chooses not to, then it will go back to them. They may supersede, or they will take that into consideration. But ultimately, as Theo's pointed out, it'd be their decision to make.
So I asked the question, what do we gain by not approving it?
To the chair, I can't answer that question. I don't know if Theo can either.
To the chair, I wouldn't know what the answer to that would be. I mean, our experience has been that we have been extending those. And I also wanted to add to Councilor Carr, they still are required, the proponent, Aon through the Mason, they're still required to submit draft plan of subdivision to go through the, you know, the lot level, similar to what they have done for all the lands south of the Lakeshore Road. This is not in any, you know, a consideration of giving them approval for what it was going there. It's just to extend that three-year period in order to give them time to submit the application. And my understanding is that they are working on coming next year with draft plan approval and official plan and zoning bylaw amendment.
So the recommendation of staff is to approve the extension. So I'll call a vote. All those in favor? 1, 2, 3, 4. Opposed? 1, 2. Okay, so it is carried. New business. I just wanted to let everybody know that, and certainly council is aware of this, that we have temporarily got a bit of a deficit in our planning department with the resignations of two of our planners, Sonia and Emily, who have gone on to other positions, and we want to thank them for their work. They were very valued to us, and you're very sorry to lose them, and they're going to be tough to replace. And I have no other new business. Is there any other new business of council? If not, Director Dodds, sorry, did I miss something?
Molly, I just one little infomercial, and that is to remind folks that in addition to the 65 Ward Street statutory public meeting, we're also having an open house for the zoning bylaw review, and we'll be posting that. We're encouraging, you know, as many members of the public to attend, and councillors as well. That's coming up. Theo, correct me if I'm wrong, it's the 26th of October, and there's information available on the website for those details. So I again, we're going to have a number of public meetings on that subject, but this is the first, and there's two sessions in the afternoon and in the evening.
Yes, and Nurse Anderson covered it at the beginning of the council meeting, and I thank him for that. And the other thing is with the 65 Ward Street presentation Zoom meeting, there is a lot of community interest. So it's going to be an interesting meeting. And with that, community development is closed, and I turn it over to Councillor Meadows.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor Anders. Parks, Recreation and Culture. Staff reports 8.1.1. Julia Snook, Director of Parks, Recreation and Culture, regarding Town Park Recreation Center expansion update. Recommend receive for information. Can I have a mover and a seconder, please? Moved by Councillor Bickel, seconded by Councillor Carr. Is there any discussion or questions, comments? Julia, was there anything you'd like to speak to on this before we put it to a vote?
Yes, thank you. Good evening, Mayor and Council. Thank you, Councillor Meadows, for the opportunity to provide a highlight related to this report. Staff are excited to be continuing to move forward with the planning steps and requirements for the expansion at Town Park Recreation Center to accommodate a new senior center. So the summary relates to the requirements for the infrastructure funding that we have received through provincial and federal support. And we are excited to continue our planning and hope to issue the release of the RFP in November and highlight to hopefully start our construction in the first quarter of 2022.
Wonderful. Thanks very much, Julia. Appreciate that. Any other comments? Yes, Mayor Sanderson.
Just to clarify, I mean, we have funding, but we don't have costs yet. Is that correct? That'll be coming forward, because the anticipation, given the delay, thanks to the federal government delay, by the way, is that, the funding may or may not align with what our original proposals were. So I just want to clarify, we do not have the ability at this point in time to know what those costs are and how they relate to the funding.
That is correct. Through you, Council Meadows, as chair, our intent is to provide the statement of work through the request for proposals. Our estimated budget, which was developed in 2019, was developed based on the square footage for the addition. So as we go through the RFP and the submissions are received, we will be able to at that point identify if there is requirements for looking at additional requirements from a budgeting standpoint based on those submissions.
So as a follow-up, my question, or what I want to kind of understand, is we're going into our budget discussions now. The finance department has asked us to identify, specific areas, that might need funding, including public meetings, etc. Are we budgeting an anticipation that, given it's a year late, that the numbers may be different than what we thought they would be, and we would have that capacity without, as an example, cutting back on the building itself, which I don't think you'd want to see. Just a response to make sure that we're not sort of planning a budget and then going to be surprised in January, like 30 days later.
Sorry, I have a little bit of a delay in my internet here. So Mayor Sanderson, to answer a question, we are hoping to review the cost that will come forward. And from a staff planning standpoint, we are estimating based on the square footage, what general costs per square footage are at this time to be able to put forward an estimate of what maybe that surplus budget may be and bring that forward through the budgeting process. If that is the case, there are options from a funding source and funding strategy that we will be working through with council from a budget standpoint.
Thank you.
Thanks, Julia. Sorry, Councillor Carr, yes?
Yeah, I'd also like to say that fortunately, when this budget was developed, there was a 15% contingency built in. So there is a slight bit of wiggle room there.
Perfect, thank you.
Good planning, finance.
Any other questions or comments from council? All right, then I'll put it to a vote. All in favor? And that's unanimous. Thank you. Thank you, Julia. New business. I have a few points to share. The Parks, Rec, and Culture staff are working on finalizing details for three indoor family movies at the Capitol Theater, with the first taking place on October 31st. This series is a replacement from the summer outdoor movie series this year, and thanks to a sponsorship from Cameco. All details will be posted on the event calendar very soon. There's some fun things taking place for Halloween in the community. PRC's Fangtastic event, photos with Pennywise in Brogdon's Lane, and Critical Mass Pumpkin Parade on November 1st. All are listed on the event calendar. The holiday season celebrations are developing as well, so stay tuned for the modified Candlelight Festival and Santa Claus Parade details. Thank you very much. And if there's no other questions or comments from council, that is Parks, Recreation, and Culture. Oh, yes, sorry, Councillor Lees, please.
Through you, Madam Chair, to one of our council reps that sit on the Police Service Board. We've asked for a couple of meetings now. Some answers on why the OPP don't enforce our no parking signs out in Silver and Glen. I just wondered if anybody had any news they could share with us.
That's on me, Councillor Lees, and I promise to have you an answer after our meeting next week with the OPP.
Okay, thank you.
I apologize.
No problem.
Thank you, Councillor Lees. All right, then that's Parks, Recreation, and Culture closed for tonight, and I'll pass it over to Works and Engineering and Councillor Mink.
Thank you very much. Works and Engineering is open. 9.1 staff reports, none. 9.2 new business. And at this point, I will pass it the chair over to Deputy Mayor Andrews to take this from here.
Okay. This is a notice of motion that was presented 2 weeks ago. And would you like me to read the notice of motion?
Yes, please.
Did somebody say yes, please?
Yes, please read it.
All right. Whereas the rural area of the municipality of Port Hope is the only area in Northumberland County that does not receive weekly roadside pickup of household recycling, organics, and garbage. And whereas the current transfer station that accepts all rural area waste requires a significant financial investment to update the facility and to meet regulatory standards related to accessibility and safety, amongst other considerations. And whereas members of council continue to routinely receive requests for roadside waste collection in the rural area, and whereas many residents do not find the location of the current station convenient, which may then encourage alternate inappropriate methods of managing waste that could potentially include burning garbage, including plastics and other materials that should not be burned. And whereas recent changes to the green bin program and expanded recycling opportunities encourages further reduction to the amount of garbage going to landfill. And whereas roadside collection would reduce the amount of vehicular traffic required to drive to and from the transfer station, leading to a reduction in overall exhaust emissions. Excuse me. And whereas Northumberland County will require time and resources to implement roadside waste collection in the rural area, now therefore be it resolved that council requests that Northumberland County implement roadside collection of garbage, recyclables, and green bin within the rural area of the municipality of Port Orange in order to better align with waste management services provided to other areas within Northumberland County, and further that council requested Northumberland County prepare an implementation plan for the requested transition to roadside waste collection within the rural area and present the transition plan once prepared to the municipality of Port Hope for considerations and support. Questions, comments? Mayor Sanderson.
This is a motion brought forward, and I think that, you know, the requirement we're really looking for is to bring this issue to the attention of council and our residents and the county. I don't think implementation is something we're really looking for at this point in time. We've had reasonable public input now, and it's very apparent that information that was needed both from the county and from our staff relative to the current environment. It's 3 years after a survey was done. There's significant changes in the provincial mandate for recycling. There are some demographic changes. So along with Councillor Mink, I'd probably like to open the discussion to moving this forward, perhaps not as the motion describes, but in asking staff to work with the county to compile the information needed for the residents to consider curbside pickup. And so that can be then considered at a future date. And I'm just gonna ask the clerk, what is the best way to manage that? Would be to perhaps we could bring this forward and put it to a vote, or maybe the mover, myself, and the seconder could modify. There's a couple of options here where the intent is to move through and get information to the residents. So the resident in input to council and council's consideration, isn't this quick.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and Mr. Chair. In this particular instance, you've got a motion on the floor. So you've got your main motion that is moved and seconded. A motion to refer this to staff, which is what sounds like was just described, that will take precedence. So any member of council could look to refer this to staff. The key there is to put parameters on what the request is of staff. So simply put, there wouldn't be a need, assuming that was passed, there wouldn't be a need to then debate the main motion again or alter the main motion. And frankly, that might be a little convoluted given the length of the motion. So the motion as it reads on the agenda is currently on the floor for debate and for consideration. A motion to defer this to a later date takes precedence, as does a motion to refer this back to staff. But again, the key, if this is to be referred back to staff, is to identify the parameters to which staff are to respond.
Okay. First, Councillor Meadows, then Councillor Mink, and then Councillor Lees.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor Anders. I'm not in favor of this. I know the mayor, you just said it within 3 years ago, with the Ward 2 was asked what they thought, and it was a resounding 70%, which I think in other conversations we've had on other topics, 70% with some of these councillors has been more than enough. So to speak a clear and loud message. If this was to go through in any way, I would suggest taking out the council request that Northumberland County implement roadside collection. That whole paragraph would definitely have to go. And I would have to be assured that, or I think many of us, that it would definitely go toward two people to have their comment and find their vote, whether it's through a questionnaire at the transfer station itself to everyone who visits it, or whether it's put on the ballot in the fall of next year. But somehow we have to hear their voices before we go any further with this.
Thank you, Councillor Mink, and then Councillor Lees.
Thank you. So I've had a number of discussions the past few weeks about why this is brought forward, and there's a lot of information that's not out in the public. The Made in Ontario Environmental Plan is a plan that was introduced after that last vote that was put to the public, and there are significant changes to that plan that puts the responsibility of the end-to-end cycle for the production of waste and the management of waste back to the producer. And that information is not in the public with anybody I have spoken to. And taking that financial responsibility away from the taxpayers and away from the consumers of product and putting it back to the producer, that is significant. And this is Ontario's way of reducing the amount of waste that we produce and managing it more effectively. In addition to that, organic waste is a big component of the Made in Ontario environmental plan. And right now, Ward 2 does not have any way of sorting and collecting organic waste. So we are the only municipality in Northumberland County that is currently sending organic waste to landfill, which the provincial requirements is to lower that by 50 to 70% within the next few years. And we don't have a way of managing that. So these are things that are not out there in the public right now. And I think that's where the mayor is suggesting that this information needs to get come out there. It's not the same situation as it was 3 years ago, 15 years ago, when these surveys went out. There's also a lot of missing information as far as those people in our community who don't have access to this service, that we fund a rural to urban community care transit system for people who cannot get to appointments and they cannot get groceries. They can't dispose of their garbage either. And no one I've spoken to is aware of this information. So these kind of pieces of information need to get out there in the public before we just put it to a yes and no vote. And if it does come to a yes and no vote, then we need to come to strategies on how to resolve this for those people who have no way of disposing of their garbage. So it's a bigger picture than just yes and no. And there's a lot of feelings, misguided information out there about animals tearing up garbage and so on. And those type of things will be resolved with this new current system. And that information has to come forward. So I support the council, the mayor's suggestion to put this back to staff, to educate the public, to educate staff, to educate council on some of these provincial changes that have come forward in the past 3 years. Thanks.
Thank you. Councilor Mees, and then Mayor Sanderson, then Councilor Bickle.
Mayor, first of all, I was quite surprised when this was put forward. I know we've received over the last few years a few emails from rural residents. But in my opinion, I really think this should go back. We did a survey in 2018. We need more input from our rural residents. They should, in my opinion, they have the final say. And I agree with the mayor. There's a lot of information that we don't have. This motion, you know, it's rather large, but very vague. And I don't think you can qualify half of the information that's in the motion about emissions and stuff like that. I know since the second stream has come on board, things have really changed in the rural collection transition place. It's improved by immense, like the amount of garbage that goes out of there. I asked the staff out there, and 2 years ago, it used to be two full 20-yard bins once a week were emptied. Now, after this new system that's put in by the county, it's about a half or three quarters of a bin a week. So, I mean, that's great strides. And, you know, people forget also there's advantages to having the transfer site. So I think, first of all, it should go back to the people, whether it be a survey, whether it be just gathering information to staff or from staff on costs, emissions, all kinds of things. Maybe council could submit a list of stuff they'd like staff to research and see what the comparators are, and then we can make a more informed decision on this topic. Thank you.
Thank you. Mayor Sanderson, then Councilor Bickle.
Yep, I just want to follow up on the requirement for the rural residents to have information. And the proposal that I have talked about is that we get and collect the information, ask staff to do so, basically on the pros and cons of curbside pickup, and work with the county and the municipality. All that fact information that's current and pertinent would then be compiled I would prefer to see every mailbox in the rural area receive that in hard copy. We know we have internet issues in the rural area, so I don't think it's fair to continue to rely on that on an important topic. This motion brings it to the table with some current requirements that are not being met. It's the survey that was put out, I obviously was involved in seeing the results and dealing with it. A survey is, in my opinion, almost any survey, not indicative of the entire population. I'm not sure everybody participated. And people who have strong opinions one way or the other can obviously kind of load them one way or the other, and that may or may not have occurred. The key issue to me is it's an important time for climate change. It's an important time for environmental activities. Recycling is a key component. And we're sort of sitting in information that's 3 or 4 years old, and it's not current. I would really like to see comprehensive information coming forward to the advantage, the disadvantage, the cost, the impact on the taxpayer. Garbage pickup is a county mandate. All the taxpayers in Northumberland are paying for garbage. So I think we have to know that impact to all taxpayers, including our own. I do not think we have the information to make a recommendation at this point in time, one way or the other. But I do, and I think you said it, Councillor Lees is a big supporter of this. We have to make sure that all that information compiled properly is then delivered and available to all rural residents. And I'm not comfortable that internet does it. I think we need to create and compile that information in conjunction with the county, get it into the hands of the residents, and get feedback from that, and then make a decision. I don't see this being a 1 or 2 week process. I think it's going to be longer. Certainly, if we could get feedback from staff for the next council meeting, we could at least understand it and then get those communications and all that information out to the rural residents, because there are going to be pros and cons. What I would like to avoid is colloquial individual responses that I don't want it. I do want it. That's not what we're looking for. What I'm hoping for is that we get an updated, comprehensive information, on curbside pickup relative to climate change, the environment, and that it is of benefit or it's not to the residents. So I look at it as this is a good start to a process.
Thank you, Councillor Bickle.
Back years ago, the former Township of Hope was awarded numerous awards for that facility out there. We were streamlining our dry, and at one point we were doing a great job at it, and then all of a sudden we were told we couldn't streamline anymore. Everything had to be put into one bag, and all that went into one bin. I've spent quite a bit of time out there in the last couple of weeks talking to residents, and for the most part, seniors. And out of all the people I talked to, I only had one person that was for curbside pickup. All the rest, say that, they are happy with what they have. They combined their trip to the transfer site with other trips to town, to other appointments. It's not out of the way to get there. They do it because they are on their way somewhere else. Some people only go once a month. Other people are every other week. People don't necessarily go every week. They kind of like the option of being able to go when they want, what day they want. A lot of the seniors' concerns that I talked to was they still have to load their waste into their vehicle, drive it down their long driveway, set it out at the side of the road. When the plow comes along and pushes it into the ditch and spreads it, they are not capable of walking in the ditches to clean up the mess. Who's going to do it? Do they phone the county? Is the county coming right out to clean the mess up? If for some reason the truck doesn't come down the road that day, they have to go back down with their vehicle, load the bags back in their vehicle, take it back to their house for the following week. That puts an extra burden on them with doing that. The comments about it, but not being accessible. I don't know how more accessible you'd have when you pull up with your car, get out of your car, go to your trunk, take two steps and dispose of your bag. That's about as accessible as you could get. A lot of residents, when it comes to green waste, they either feed it to their livestock or they compost themselves. So, you would not get a big number of green bins and people going the green way because their livestock are still going to eat that waste, whether other people are putting it in green bins or not. If you want to find out what people actually think, then I would suggest council take a day or a couple of days of the week and go out there and visit the waste site, talk to the residents. You will be amazed at the comments you will get and the different opinions people have on it. Thing about, people not being able to get there, they don't have transportation. Well, 95% of people that do not drive do not move to the country. You pretty well are assured that there is no bus coming down your road every day to take you to town. So you're not going to move to the country if you do not drive. And there are seniors out there, yes, who maybe are handicapped, but they do have neighbors and family who are willing to take their stuff to the transfer site for them. So like I say, if you really want to know what the people are thinking instead of something shoved into a mailbox, I suggest council go out in pairs, spend a day or two there out of a month and talk to the residents, and you will get a full disclosure of what people are thinking. This part about having to spend lots of money to upgrade it, no, there's no need of it. A few new signs put up on the post to say, this goes in this bin, this goes in this bin. We were doing it once before. You can go back to be doing that again without a lot of money being spent. From what I've heard and seen of the new proposal on what they want to do, where they want to put the bins in the spring when snow melt comes, that becomes a big lake. So then you're going to be putting seniors and residents out into a big lake to try to manipulate to each bin to get rid of what they're trying to dispose of, which isn't going to work. And once you get a big pond out there and it freezes, you have a big sheet of ice. How are we going to contend with that? There are things that are there that don't add up and don't make sense to me. I've not seen anything about any changes, physically, and whether it's being sent to the accessibility committee for them to look at. We do it with any other project in the municipality. This should be the same way if it goes forward. So those are just a few of my comments for now.
Quite a few, I mean. Thank you very much. Councillor Ming?
Thank you. For the comments made by Councillor Bickle, these are all relevant points of view, but for every one of these arguments, there is a counter argument. And absolutely, the people that if you stand outside the transfer station, you are going to get people who are happy with it because they're able to get there. But if you go door to door and speak to people throughout the municipality, you'll get a different point of view because there are many people who actually don't use it because they cannot get there. So you're really pinpointing the people that are using it. As far as a rural transit, that you said we don't have one in the rural area. As of last Thursday, the Community Care Rural Transit offered 1,950 rides so far this year to rural residents who have no way, no type of transportation. So we do have a rural transit that people depend on, and it doesn't stop at the transfer station. But what I would like to say about the vote, I just want to clarify that the vote was not 70% last time in favor. The vote, I believe, was 64%. And a valid point is that the vote on this issue, it's very valid. It's good to know what people, how they feel. And I don't disagree with that. But the vote was one vote per household, which meant the head of the household, the person who had the say, had the vote. And I know of many households who were divided on this issue. And we are here as council to make these decisions because we have the information. And I think putting a yes and no vote out to the public, the only way that is democratic is if it's done on a ballot at the election. Putting a survey in a mailbox and giving it to the loudest voice in that household is not a democratic way. And I don't think that we should be using that as a point of reference. But again, I believe that we need to put this information out there, re-educate the public on the benefit of the new Made in Ontario environmental plan, the cost savings, shifting that cost to the producers, and go from there. I think this motion brings that discussion forward, and I'm happy if we leave tonight with putting a motion towards staff to bring this information forward and bring the discussion forward.
I think that's everybody's made excellent points for and against. And I do want to just throw something else out there that when we talk rural, we're not talking just north of the 401. I mean, we've got the west, all of Mason Homes is rural. So they're going to have a voice in this, and that will change some of the survey results if we went to a survey, which I'm not saying we're doing. But anyways, having said all that, and I've listened, we've all listened, I think I'd like to get the motion on the floor to receive the recommendation as presented by our Director Gilmer. And can I get to, did we put that motion on?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. No, there's the current motion is as listed on the agenda. That's the main motion at hand. Again, if there is a want to refer this to staff, it will have to be voted on. That takes precedent over the main motion. We'll need a mover and a seconder. And again, some parameters on what that request would entail.
Okay, who would like to take a stab at the motion? Councillor Carr.
I would like to refer this back to staff to get information on the current provincial guidelines that we are mandated to meet. I would also like to understand the cost comparisons, and I would like a qualification on some of the environmental impacts that have been discussed.
Can I suggest that we include in that direction that the county be involved in that process in bringing all information forward to both the residents and councillors? Because this really is, in my mind, an attempt to get all the information, up so we can consider, for the residents of the rural area, whether the curbside pickup is the best thing or not. I don't know what the outcome will be, but I think the primary request that I think Councillor Mink and I are asking for is to bring it to the table so we can deal with current, legislation changes in demographics and what have you. I don't think our staff should do that alone. I think we need to work with county staff to bring forward the information. The county is responsible for garbage, full stop. So I would just, I guess I'm saying if we could include in what you're asking for, that include the our staff working with county staff.
Thank you, Councilor Lees.
I'd like to include that staff get a cost of how to get input in a hard copy form out to all the rural residents, what that would cost as well. Because I agree with the mayor, I think hard copy going out to the rural resident would be the best way to collect their input. Because I mean, ultimately, again, like I said, it should come down to the rural residents, what they want, because in a lot of other cases, we've always give them what they want. So, and I'd also like their input on other things. So to find out a costing on a hard copy for rural residents would be also included. I would like to see that.
Okay, where did we get to? Are we specific enough, Director Gilmer?
Well, we had a motion, and before that was seconded, we had additions to that motion. And before that was seconded, we had additions to that motion. So to answer your question, Mr. Chair, no, but I think we're getting close.
I will second it.
I think we need so that the original motion is now being seconded, but I think it might benefit council to just compile some of this into one motion, if it pleases council, and refer this matter back to staff to work with Northumberland County staff to gather additional information on current provincial guidelines associated with waste management, and to identify cost comparisons between the two models. And further, to qualify and investigate the environmental impacts associated with each of the two models and bring this information back for consideration.
How does that sound? Can we write that, David?
Yeah, thanks. I just wanted to comment, and the mayor made the point, I think it's a critical point, is that waste management is the responsibility of the county. It is not a responsibility of a lower tier municipality, and we don't have the expertise in-house that the county would. So I think the mayor's point is extremely well taken. We will work with our county colleagues who are the experts on this issue and be somewhat driven by their timeline and their ability and their willingness to work with us. I have no doubt that they will, but we do need to work with them and we'll rely on them.
Thank you. So we have Director Gilmer's motion on.
If you give me a couple seconds, Mr. Chair, I'll share my screen that council can be sure we're considering the same matter.
When you're typing, are you using all fingers?
I use two at a time, but I do it rather quickly.
From a process perspective, this will take precedent over the original motion?
Yes. For those that have just joined us, this is Zen Meditation Council.
Let's see. We don't currently have a mover and seconder for this particular motion. This is what we've sort of come up with based on the different input. It's not my finest work, but I think it gathers the conversation that's been had here tonight.
I will move that since it's pretty much what I had put forward.
All right. Can I get a mover, please? So I can't see everybody. I see Councillor Carr. And seconder. Seconded by Mayor Sanderson. Any further discussion on this? Councillor Lees?
Clerk, does that include the part about is costing included in there from the residents to Northumberland County to find out from the residents what they want in a paper ballot? Is that costing part in there?
Short answer, no, I don't believe so. The intention here is that this be brought back to committee for further review. If there's a want to also include cost comparison or have those cost comparison requests or community consultation of some sort conducted, we can add that. I would need some suggested wording for that.
Councilor Lees, and then Mayor Sanderson.
Just the last time that we put this back on the county, and basically they didn't want to do it because of the cost for a survey or whatever. So I think that should be included in there because we did formally ask them to make a decision and they put it back onto us. So And I think the main reason they put it back onto us was stating they didn't want to pay the cost for the survey or whatever they wanted to do. That's what I gathered, because we did ask them earlier to help us with this, but we got no cooperation.
Mayor Sanderson?
I totally agree with the concept that we need to get hard copy out to the residents. And I also like the idea of, it's also an opportunity for us to perhaps have more information delivered. And all communications should have a call to action, in my opinion. I don't know if it's necessary to put that in here, but I have no objection to it, to just say, and to, like, I don't know who's going to be obligated or who will be willing to undergo a cost to say, do a hard copy and send it out to our residents in Ward 2. I'd like to know that cost, I guess, but I don't want the county not participating and getting convoluted, because a mail out to residents in Ward 2 is not something they want to do. I think it's something we want to do, and I think it will need to be done, but I wouldn't mind if things stayed the way they were. It came back, we had the information, and if we pursued all that information, then I feel maybe it's our responsibility to communicate that information and maybe some others to the residents. So I'm just trying not to get it convoluted in this particular motion, but it's probably not hard to put in there if people are more comfortable with it, which would just be maybe it's something along the lines of, looking at, county and staff maybe look at the costs of, a hard communication out to the residents of Ward 2 with the findings, whatever we come out of it. I don't want to bog the county down where they can debate, well, yes for that, not for that. We'll work with them to get the information, and we all agree, I think, that we need to get that information out to all rural residents, and that the method is not modern technology, but it might be the mailbox, which I think is great.
Like watching closed captioning on TV. Councilor Mink, did you have something to add?
Well, I was just going to, say almost similar to what the mayor was saying. And just to clarify Councilor Lee's point, I don't think we're asking for a survey and the cost of conducting a survey and putting that on the county at this time. We're just asking for circulating the information at this time and then bring that forward. Just wanted to clarify that we're not asking for a survey.
They can gather information any way they want. Thank you. Okay.
So, Mr. Chair.
Yes.
Highlighted in yellow, you have an amendment to the motion to refer. If this is sort of meeting the needs of committee, we can first have a motion, a mover and seconder, to amend this motion to refer by adding that additional information in yellow.
Could we have a motion to move to adopt the portion in yellow? Can I get a mover and a seconder? Moved by Councilor Lee, second by Councilor Carr. All in favor? Thank you. Unanimous.
Okay, so now we have what you see here is the current motion on the floor. And this is back to the motion to refer. So at this point in time, this takes precedent over the main motion, and you would be voting on what you see here in front of you. And once we've done that, we're done for tonight.
Okay, so can I have a mover to accept this motion? Moved by Councilor Carr, second by Mayor Sanderson. All those in favor? Any opposed? Fine, thank you. Thank you, Director Gilmer. And thank you to everybody. That was spirited conversation again. And I'll turn this back over to Councillor Mink.
Thank you. So I have one more item of new business, and I know it's getting late, but I think that this is an important one. So I have more to read here. We've received a letter, and it is regarding Jeanette Davidson graduation from AMCTO Executive Diploma in Municipal Management. So we just want to take a, I want to take a moment to acknowledge that accomplishment and read this letter that we have received. So it says, on behalf of the Association of Municipal Managers, Clerks and Treasurers of Ontario, I'm extremely pleased to announce that Jeanette Davidson has successfully completed the intensive process to graduate from the Association's Executive Diploma in Municipal Management. We believe that this is a tremendous accomplishment and should be regarded with pride by your municipality. Founded in 1938 with a membership of more than 2,200 municipal professionals across the province, AMCTO is proud to be the largest municipal professional or association in Ontario with the mandate to provide high quality education and professional development programs in order to foster municipal excellence in the province. The Executive Diploma in Municipal Administration is the most comprehensive career development program designed specifically for Ontario municipal managers. Graduates of this diploma program are informed leaders with a comprehensive understanding of the complex and interrelated components of municipal management and who can immediately implement their knowledge and thus have an integrated and positive impact on any municipal corporation. Jeanette has successfully completed the rigorous evaluation process to graduate from this diploma. We hope that you and your colleagues on council will join us in congratulating Jeanette on this significant achievement. So that is in reading. So congratulations to Jeanette. And I just wanted to also say that in working with her, my personal message, it is very motivating and encouraging to work closely with a member of our leadership team who is continuously striving to improve herself and invest into broadening her skills and knowledge so she can better help the community. And not to take away from her accomplishments here tonight, but I also want to acknowledge that through her example and dedicated leadership, there are many other staff members on her team who are doing the same and following her example by improving their skills and their knowledge. So congratulations, and It's a great, good news story to almost end the night off.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I really appreciate it. I'm glad we're not in person. You can't tell I'm really blushing.
And I will pass this over to CAO Smith.
Yeah, thank you very much, Councillor Mink, for that. And I just wanted to build on that. One of the greatest joys of my career is I get to work with smart and talented people. And I can remember one of the first times I met Jeanette. She talked very passionately about continuous learning and investing in continuous development for her and her staff. So I think the accomplishment that you've articulated tonight is a true testament of somebody that is doing what they say they will do and doing it well. And as you indicated, Councillor Mick, Jeanette has a number of staff successfully completing a variety of programs. A lot are motivated by her example, and her portfolio is broad, it's big, it's complex, it's all of those things, but she does manage to carve out a time to make sure she's learning. And I just wanted to pass on my congratulations on behalf of the administrative team to her as well.
Thank you very much. And Mayor Sanderson?
Obviously all the accolades, and I want to keep you blushing. So we'll you know, say the same sort of thing. But honestly, from a municipal perspective, you know, you're showing clear leadership and you're implementing the higher education, the self-development that I think you will have council supporting throughout. There's no better investment that I think, you know, council, municipality can make than in our staff. And I know and see how hard you work, and accomplishing this accomplishment isn't a small step. I mean, it's, in my opinion, it's like a postgraduate degree while you're doing a full-time job. So congratulations. And I really, you know, commend you on it. We've sort of traveled together through as we've, you know, advanced the career, and it's absolutely amazing. The leadership, you know, and I think a demonstration of the investment that I think municipality and council will continue to support. So it's worth every minute of tonight and having the letter. And anybody else who wants to weigh in, you have our full support, and our CAO is driving and supporting that council continue to understand the value of staff, and we continue to invest, and it's the best investment we can make. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, everyone. That's very sweet. Really appreciate it. Right.
And are there any more comments for Jeanette or comments for Works and Engineering from Councillor, from the rest of Council? Okay, so Works and Engineering is closed, and I will pass this to Councillor Bickel.
Thank you, Councillor Mick. Fire emergency service is now open. 10.1 staff reports, none. 10.2 new business. I have a couple things here. During Fire Prevention Week, Port Hope Fire attended over 600 homes dropping off prevention and information for adults and children. We also assisted and was conducting fire drills at our schools in the community. October 18th was the end of Fire Prevention Week, which didn't end well for the community. We had a tragic fatal fire. Our thoughts are with the family and friends of the two victims who perished in that fire. The Ontario Fire Marshals, with assistance of Port Hope Fire and Port Hope Police, have concluded an on-site portion of the investigation. The cause will not be released at this time. Also on October 18th, residents may have seen fire trucks from Coburg and Hamilton Township and Clarington in our municipality. As part of our mutual aid program, other fire services provided assistance during that major event, whether it be on scene or at standby at a fire station. A big thank you goes out to Clarington and Coburg for assisting with two medical emergencies that occurred elsewhere in the community at that same time as the fire. On October 16th, members of the Municipal Emergency Group met for their annual review on hazardous identification and risk assessment, and as well as critical infrastructure listing as part of our annual compliance. Later in November, the group will reconvene to conduct our annual emergency preparedness training exercise. And October 14th, various members of Port Hope Fire attended the Lightning Bolt Awards hosted by Northumberland EMS. Each year, EMS recognizes police, fire, EMS, and dispatchers that have played a role in bringing a patient back to life through the use of CPR. The ceremony is specific to events that have occurred across the municipalities of Northumberland County. This year, 12 incidents were recognized, with three of the actual patients in attendance for the ceremony. Port Hope Fire was involved in three of the 12 medical emergencies that patients were brought back to life. Good job done by all, and just shows how well our training works and the dedication that our members put in, whether it's fire, police, EMS, they all put their heart into it and do a great job when they're called upon. So other than that, if there's nothing for fire emergency services from anybody, fire emergency services is closed.
We'll take the next step, which is to go into a question period. Is there anything out of tonight's agenda that council has any questions about? I don't see any. I'm going to turn it over to the clerk and request to find out if there are the public or media with any questions at this point.
Thanks, Mr. Mayor. As we always note, the instructions to pose a question are posted along with the agenda. You simply go ahead and indicate you have a question through the raise hand function. If you are following along via telephone, when you get to a question, in order to raise your hand, you would press star nine and then press star 6 in order to unmute if you are called upon. So with that in mind, and understand that we have a few attendees left on the line, we'll go ahead and open this up for questions. We do have one question from a call-in user, so I'm going to go ahead and unmute you. Follow the prompts, and you'll be able to ask your question of council after you identify your name and street address.
Hi, my name is Paul, and I live at 3192 Roseberry Hill Road. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can, Paul. You can go ahead with your question.
Okay, it's not so much a question as it is a statement about the pickup. And I just want to say that with the state that the world is in today with climate change, how disappointed I am that people in Ward 2 aren't lining up to try and heal this planet by accepting pickup, curbside pickup. It's just asinine. And I've gone out to the transfer site. I never came across Mr. Bickle. And if I had, I would have been, according to him, one of the few that would have said, I want curbside pickup. This is the 21st century, for God's sakes. We're the only ward, like was already stated, that doesn't have it. And it's crazy. It's just crazy with the state of the world, climate change, carbon going into the air, people burning garbage on their property that they shouldn't because they're not taking it out to where it needs to go, so forth and so on. I know there's a lot of other problems that were stated in this meeting, but none of it matters if we don't have a planet to live on.
I'm going to thank
That's
you
all
for
your, I wanted to say.
Yep, no, I appreciate it very much. We do try to keep it to questions. And the process will certainly allow everyone in the rural area to have input. And we're going to commit and assure that happens. And we're also committed to bringing the information both for and against and all the components that you've talked about. But I appreciate you bringing the comments forward and ask if there's anybody else with questions.
Thanks, Mr. Mayor. There's no indication of any further questions at the moment.
All right. And before we adjourn, I just want to make maybe two comments. First off, this is a little longer meeting than we normally have, but I think as our CAO and perhaps some of our other staff would indicate, it's still an early night compared to many, many councils. So, I don't want to feel that we're hard done by. And the reason we had a little bit longer council than normal is we had, I think, very healthy and respectful discussions on some very hard topics. And that's what we do as council. So I'm really wanting to thank both staff and all council, for the dialogue and the way we managed through this evening. And I want to specifically thank Brian. You've helped us through, some processes and procedures as to how to move things forward properly. So I certainly appreciate that input coming forward. And I just want to make those comments before I ask for a mover to adjourn and a seconder to do so. So can I have a mover to adjourn? Nobody wants to quit. Councilor Lee's put his hand up first and the deputy mayor second. So all those in favor of adjournment? Reluctantly. Thanks, guys. All right. You have a good night, everybody. Stay safe and thanks again.